Bobby Hall event on April the 4th.
Hey, Bobby, turn it on.
It's not on.
Complains, complain.
Okay, let's see what we've
got. You all are so demanding, isn't it? But on Saturday, April the 4th, Benjamin Grobner, one of the young guys we heard last week, he's performing at Spivey. And don't miss that. That's just going to be 7:30 on this Saturday night, and it's just a spectacular concert. You ought to be there. The other one I want to mention, I've got a May 2nd, the Atlanta Master Chorale is performing at Emory. They are just, they're about the best choral group I've ever heard. And they are so good. And they're performing at Schwartz at Emory.
What's
just
the date?
Great.
What are they performing?
Sorry?
What are they performing?
They're doing the Missa Solemnis again. But I mean, they're just so good. And their Christmas program is just out of this world. And you're looking around and you say, well, I guess Bob Edge has lost his appeal or something with this smaller crowd. But let me tell you, this is the answer to prayer. I've been complaining for years. Why we used to have such a rich offering with so many diverse things. And Andy Barnett, one of our new people on staff, he's beefing it up. So Sarah Hill and her cohorts, they are doing something on the Atlanta race riots and that sort of thing. And then Harriet Schaffer, she's doing a thing on resident care. So this is wonderful. This is what we want. So many of us entered the All Saints through the door of Sunday school. They called it adult formation. I'm already formed, I have it there. So anyhow, this is Sunday school for me. This is a good thing, and I'm delighted that that's all happening. Okay, today, first of all, let's see what else I want to do. I want to dedicate this class to Wade Mitchell. Wade's got flu, and they've been
he's well.
He and Mary Lou, and they've also done the videotaping of past sessions. So, Wade, we're sending you our best, and hope you feel better and all of that, and thanks for all you do. Okay, now, today we are going to talk about the two superstar tenors, Juan Diego Flores and Jonas Kaufman. Now, so many of us, we think about Pavarotti and Placido Domingo. They really dominated in the 80s and the 90s especially. But today's two, leading guys are Flores and Kaufman. And I want to start by telling you a little bit about tenors. Tenors, this is the spectrum of tenors. You've got lyric tenors. And lyric tenors, their voices are lighter and higher. Sometimes they can go up to, very rare instances, they can go up to a high F. It's unbelievable. A lot of them you don't want to hear. Their voices are, since they're lighter, they're more flexible, and they can do runs and trills and all that. I mean, we call that coloratura, as you know. And so many of these roles are called bel canto roles. That's Rossini, Donizetti, and Bellini, and they were writing between 1810 and 1850. And some of those beautiful, wonderful operas we have are written by those composers. Then at the other end of the spectrum are the dramatic tenors, and they are heavier and darker. And you will hear this in the two singers we're going to hear today. It's just obvious. Kaufman is darker, weightier, all of that. He's going to have less flexibility. They seldom go above a high C. They are under tense conditions, stressful conditions. They said, got this high C coming up, and they're dying as they're thinking about, I've got that high C coming up. Later Verdi and later Wagner are in that category. In between is something called a spinto. Everybody say spinto.
Spinto.
Spinto. And it's in between. It's kind of on the end of the spectrum of dramatic tenors, where it's not quite as heavy or as dark as the pure dramatic tenors. And so you can hear this. And so what happens with tenors is young Pavarotti sang a lot of roles in this part of the spectrum in his early career. Then he got older and he moves over here. And he even sang, you know, Otello or that sort of heavier voices. That happens with tenors all the time. And think about Placido Domingo started here, and the last 10 to 15 years, he's only sung baritone roles. So again, and the other thing I've got to tell you, a lot of people who direct opera companies and make the artistic choices, they think, oh, he couldn't possibly sing, you know, this role. He should be here. He can't sing here, this or that. Well, in the old days, tenors sang everything, because if they were in a small, they were in a smaller German city or whatever else, they had to use the resources. So it's been something like a jet plane that allows people to go all over the world, that they can say, oh no, we insist on having, you know, this voice quality, and we can't possibly tolerate this kind of tenor. If you see what I'm saying, it's all kind of interesting. All right, let's see. Oh, now when you're listening to the tenors today, what we want to think, what are the things that come into how we grade them, how we react to them? We want them to sing on pitch. and sometimes you say, oh, can't they get up all the way to the note, or they just under it? Vibrato, how does the vibrato go? Some vibratos drive me crazy, and others are just wonderful. It's an enhancement of the sound, but you get in situations where they use their voice for roles that are too heavy in the early, and they develop this wobble. You don't want to hear that. But so, how is the vibrato going? This was, you know, became a real problem for Maria Callas. You know, she was so glorious in the early, and then she developed vocal problems, and then her vibrato became and it was, you know, it's just so sad. And somehow they don't know. Maybe it's time for me to stop. You know, so, but yeah, vibrato is important. Breathing. How conscious you are you of the breathing? And some people with have giant lungs or whatever else, they can just carry these phrases and go on and on. And it's you can think about the breathing. You want to have the same vocal quality from the bottom voice to the top voice. You don't want to hear a changing of gears. And that's, some people, I mean, they just, it's noticeable. They're moving from their middle voice to their higher voice. You don't want to be aware of that. We want that to be a seamless sound. We want the rhythm to be exact. You know, and some singers are better in making sure they're right on the rhythm than others, but that's important. Coordination with others. Got to sing duets, got to sing with the chorus, you got to be with the orchestra. How good are they at that blending of what they're doing with the other musicians who are producing the sounds? Dynamics. Some singers have a tendency always to sing at the same dynamic level. Well, it's so much better when they can, you know, you've got this variation in the dynamics between the soft and the loud. Some of them can't do anything evidently except sing loud, and that becomes boring. Then there's this, you know, mystical quality. The ability to excite. Some people, you know, just have this ability to excite. And I think I've told you this before, but we've done things in the past, and I would compare singers. Let's take it, Pavarotti and Domingo. And I think, well, I like that baritonal sound more and everything. Every time I would select the Pavarotti recording because it was more exciting. I don't know how you did it. But it was, at least that was my reaction to it. Maybe a different voice quality would excite you. And then finally, diction. I know a few operatic Italian words, a few German things, but I don't do it. But this, with people who are really connoisseurs and they speak the languages, they want to know what the diction is. Two Sundays ago, we heard Jesse Norman, and her diction was, you know, spectacular. Until she started overdoing it, and then it became a distraction. But and one thing as far as diction is concerned is that when you have a high note, it's easier to have an open ah sound than an E sound. See, you see, say E, E. Well, you see why your voice. Well, say ah. So your voice is more open. You know, at that point, well, these great singers, they just cheat so much to get the right sound. My Lord, Joan Sutherland is supposed to be this high note's supposed to be on a kind of an E sound. It's off. It's really amazing. So they, but in the end, they said, I want the beautiful sound that suits my voice. I'm willing for them to cheat. I like that thrill when they can give you the better C. Okay, now, then we move to our first tenor. And this guy is something. A little bit about his life. This is Juan Diego Flores. Say Flores.
Flores.
And he was born in Lima in 1973. He's now about 47. He's a lyric tenor from Peruvian. His father was a guitarist, singer. His mama owned a pub with popular singers. And early on in his life, when the popular singer got sick, Flores would substitute. And so he had to be able to sing all these things. He said he learned a ton doing this practical job in his mother's pub. He went to the National Conservatory to become a pop singer, and at that time his classical voice emerged. He went to the Curtis Institute. We talked about Curtis Institute before. That's one of the two or three finest music schools that we have in our country. He was there for 3 years on a scholarship, and while there he developed a specialty in singing bel canto roles, especially Rossini. And this is a typical career. You're from someplace else, and you go for the early years to Europe because they have so many opera houses, smaller opera houses, and they get a chance to sing lots of stuff. And they're training somebody. They move on to La Scala or Vienna, and then he went to the Met in 2002. That's a typical career. One reason why Jesse Norman started over there was still this hangover of discrimination against black people. And so she went over there where there wasn't as much discrimination. Let's see, in 2007, he sang an encore after Les Amis, the one of the arias we're going to hear. That's the one with nine high C's. And it was the first time that had been done in 74 years. Now again, that's the excitement we're talking about. People get so excited, they just kept applauding until after 74 years, he got to sing an encore. He did the same thing in New York. In 2011, a dramatic event, he was present at the birth of his son, and 1 hour later, he did a worldwide broadcast from the event.
No.
Guys, he's a strong fellow. Okay, we're going to hear three of his arias. This is everybody, a lot of you know this beautiful aria, Una Furtiva Lagrima, a secret tear. This is this peasant, and he says, oh, I saw a furtive tear, a secret tear in my lover's eye, and I take that, I know she loves me. And he rhapsodizes about her and all that. This is a bel canto aria, and bel canto, this is where you show the beauty of the voice and the flexibility, and at the end we're going to hear this a short cadenza that is unaccompanied, and he does a run or whatever else and lands on a high note. So he's going to give us, this one is mainly about the beauty of the voice. And this guy's got a beautiful voice, I tell you that. So we have an introduction with the bassoon. And what that's doing is getting you familiar with the main tune before it's going to be sung by the tenor. Today we can become familiar listening to the CDs over and over again. They didn't have CDs in whatever year this was, 1825 or whatever. Una furtiva lagrima. Sweet quality. pretty good, wouldn't you say? Okay, now we're going to move to the aria that made Pavarotti famous first. We've heard this two or three times before. This is from the Daughter of the Regiment, and this is called a cavatina, and that's a more song-like aria. And this is one that has the nine high C's. And we're going to hear the first 2 minutes and skip about 3 minutes and skip and go to the last one. And what you want to do is listen to this when we get to the high C part and say, does he really have a nice tone on the high C's? Is it a high C you want to hear? He may get there, but you may not want to hear it. Do you like the quality of his high C? Or is he just squeaking out a note? And you have to be very careful about a lot of people who try to sing this and really can't do it. Now, and this is what happened. You know the story of the daughter of the regiment. There was this baby girl who was abandoned in the war, the Napoleonic War. Before then. And she's raised by a troop of French soldiers. And so she's the daughter of the regiment. And you know, and it's a wonderful story. It's funny and all that. But so much of the excitement about this opera comes from this "Amazing Me." We'll hear the "Amazing Me," and what he's saying. Oh, I'm so glad I've joined. He was Swiss, but he's joined the French regiment so he can be closer to his lady friend. And he's asking her fathers, that's the regiment, is asking them to give permission for him to marry, you know, the girl, the daughter. And they say, oh, you know, I'm not kind of sure of this. And he says, but she loves me. She loves me a lot. And they say, oh, if that's the case, you can get married. So, anyhow.
Was the girl consulted at all?
Yes. She loved it. She loved it. She was very much a part of all this. Okay, here we go.
Thank you.
The guy you've been waiting for is coming. And then in the aria he says, now he's going to make everything right. He's going to make the crooked straight. And that's, and again, this was written, this is very interesting to me. Handel had had this big career in England, especially in London, and prosperous. And then the style moved on, and he was losing money, and he was near bankruptcy. So then he's going to have to change his career to so it would return to success, and he hoped to achieve that by writing oratorios. So he had the introduction of the Messiah, and it was in Dublin. And he went there, and of course, the rest is history with the Messiah, you know, the world's most popular oratorio, maybe. But, all right, let's see, what number is this? It's 5. This is beautiful singing. In the first part, he wants to show you the beauty of his voice. And then in the aria, he's going to do more runs and trills and that sort of thing. Okay, come on. This is right after the orchestral introduction to the Messiah. It comes early on.
Prepare me the way of the Lord. Make
51. He's just slightly older than Flores. Born in Munich in 69. His father was in insurance. His mother was a kindergarten teacher. He started playing the piano at 8. So many people start playing at 8. That's their get their basic music structure in their head. He went to the University of Munich of Music in Munich, and then he began having small roles in the Munich opera companies. Then he had a vocal crisis, and it looked like it was all over. And then he discovered this American baritone, forgot to write down his name, but he was saved by who told him how to get his voice back in shape, to get over the problem he had. And Kaufman credits him with the success of his career. So he begins his career in Germany, then he goes to Chicago and La Scala in 2006, he got to the Met. He is a spinto dramatic tenor. That means he's in between the lyric and the dramatic tenor. In his early career, he was singing, you know, some of the roles. He sang in Carmen, and he would sing these lighter roles. And as he's gotten old, and he even sings some Wagnerian roles, like the lighter ones in Lohengrin. And then he's moved to the heavier roles later in his life. Then he had a lymph node in his chest and had to go through surgery. And 3 months later, he was singing Faust. So unbelievable. He recovered well. Not all of them recover. His first wife, he had three children. Now he's married to an opera director. They have a child. The New York Times said that Kaufman is the most important, versatile tenor of the generation. And it's hard to argue with that. I mean, basically, he can sing whatever he wants to. He said, mount this opera for me. And they said, we're glad you, because we know it's going to sell out if you're in it. And he's unbelievable. He's unbelievable. So we're going to, the first one we're going to hear is this, it's about a minute and a half, this aria. And it's called Amor Ti Dieta. And it's, this is, you're going to see immediately the difference in the lyric tenor and the dramatic tenor when we listen to this. This is a gorgeous aria, huh? By Giordano. Hey, come on. This guy, he's unbelievable. Has this gorgeous legato singing with a dark quality weight in his voice, and he's just at the top. Now, we're going to listen. A lot of you all know this aria. This is Vesti la Giubba from Pagliacci, and this is a Verismo opera. Verismo, this is opera's going to have, you know, regular people in regular situations instead of gods and the great nobles. This is about ordinary people. And that's what verismo means realistic. And you're going to hear some gorgeous singing here. And again, the top note is going to be A, but it sounds like it's much higher. And he's going to, it has this beautiful character of the phrase. Now, one thing he's got to do in this big dramatic, what's going on is this guy Canio has a younger wife, and she's cheating on him, but he still has to, you know, put on his clown outfit and act happy and all of that. And his heart, he says, I have to laugh while my heart is breaking. And this is about as dramatic as an aria gets. So listen to this. You've got to say at the end, his big line is really Pagliaccio, which means laugh clown. Everybody say, reading Pagliaccio. Reedy Collins. And so, and he's going to cheat on the Reedy, I have to tell you. He's supposed to be Reedy. He said, Reedy Collins. That's okay. It's so gorgeous you don't mind it. This is dramatic as an opera is. And it's not good. You know, there's pitched. You know that? I'll forgive him because of the rest of the stuff he does.
Thank you.
has the high sustained C. And this is, he's got to be sweating at this point. Nessun Dorma, everybody knows Nessun Dorma, because it's been made the most famous opera aria. And you know, the story here, this is Puccini, of course, Turandot, and she's the daughter of the emperor and all these guys. She's so gorgeous, they look at her and say, oh, got to marry you. And she says, well, you can do that only if you can answer my three riddles, and if you don't answer them right, I'm going to cut off your head. So, anyhow, well, here, Caliph, you know, has answered it, and she goes in berserk. I can't marry a man. It's awful. And so she'd had her grandmother or somebody, you know, one ancestor, had a terrible time with men, and so she hates all men. And so he says, okay, I don't want to marry you if you don't love me. So I'll tell you this. You'll have one more chance. If you can find out my name before sunrise, then you can cut off my head. And so she said, oh, no one can sleep. She tells all the Chinese, no one can sleep. Everybody's got to work on finding out the name. And so Nessun Dorma means nobody sleeps. So anyhow, she's got till sunrise. Well, it's about to get light, and he can't wait for the night to be over. So he's got his plan. He says, they're not going to find out. And when at sunrise, I'm going to tell her my name, then I'm going to kiss her, and then that will be that. He had lots of confidence in himself. She'll love me, and we can, it's all going to, we'll live happily ever after, and all that sort of thing. And so, and he says, when I do that, I'm going to be victorious. And he says, Vincero, Vincero. Okay, now you've got to get ready to sing, because we're all going to do this get to the big climax. So it's Vincero, Vincero. Everybody do it. Vincero, Vincero. Okay, all right, here we go.
This is the opera about 35 years ago. He taught us so that we could go to hear the Metropolitan sing it. Same song. Same opera.
Thank you.
Thomas comes in.
This is Bob's lucky wife. She lives with this all the time.